morning, everyone.
Maybe a bit of a strange subject to have in a QA meeting, but I did try to make the talk at least QA related, so I'm going to talk about quality assurance in the DI development process. And the main thing we have to do is to manage breakage. Basically, the installer has been broken in testing and unstable for the last 2 months, ever since the big transition started. We have had occasional days that were good days and we could actually test the image, but most days have been basically hell. We have not been able to move anything to testing from unstable because there just wasn't a point to do it. We would have liked to release beta release for Edge by now, about a month back was the original planning, but we have not been able to do so just because the whole environment was continually so much changing and we were not able to stabilize things to get a release out. So this is about how do we try to handle that, deal with it. It's in three parts, and let's start with a little introduction. Well, first of all, what types of breakage do we see? Breakage can be either general, that means everything breaks, all installation methods for all architectures, or it can be specific to a certain installation method or to a certain architecture. That's mostly the case when there's something wrong with bootloaders or with initRD configuration, stuff like that. You can have build failures. That's not that bad, to be honest, because if we have build failure, then we just don't have a new image for a day, but the old images will still be there. Anyway, the breakage in building can be either while building the DI images themselves or when building CD images that include the DI images. DI images are basically the kernel that's used in the image, in the CD, and the initRD that is used. You can have, well, basic installation problems. The installer won't boot. You will have problems with selecting keyboards, the keyboard won't work, whatever. You can have problems during the base installation phase, that is when the bootstrap is broken, which, well, it was quite a while after the migration, after Sarge was released, because, well, basically Edge was not supported yet in the bootstrap. So we had to wait around for that. You can have problems in base configuration, that's after the reboot, after the first reboot. So that's problems with things like task cell. You can have problems installing tasks because dependencies are broken. And that's basically been the problem for the last 2 months with the major transitions going on and things depending on each other and not wanting to be installed. And a totally separate type of problem is internationalization problems. And those can happen in either the first stage of the installation or the second stage. The environment for foreign languages is fairly different between first stage and second stage. So often we see that something goes right in first stage, but it fails in second stage. And especially when you have languages like Arabic, where there's really different issues than normal Latin-based languages, well, you can have very funny things happening. DI is really a complex environment and should be seen as a miniature Linux distribution that has to support all 12 architectures of the system. And that's a challenge in itself. It really is a full distribution because it has its own kernel, it has its own environment, because you have the micro depths, the UDEPs instead of normal depths, so you have the problems associated with that. We use library reduction to make sure everything is fits in as small space as possible, so we can do floppy based installations and low memory installations. So there are different challenges in creating a DI distribution, if you would like to call it that, from doing a normal Debian distribution. Having all architectures means you also have a great variety in stuff that you have to support, like different disk labels, different file systems, different bootloaders, stuff like that. There are some components we control ourselves. There's quite a bit of programming involved in DI, mostly scripting, but also some C, some other stuff. A lot of configuration, of course. But others we do not. And, well, if something breaks there, we often are dependent on the maintainer of that part of the Debian to provide a solution. And very often, you have UDEPs, stuff we use in the installer, that are really produced as a byproduct of normal packages. And that means that very often the UDEPs and what happens there is not really in the front of the mind of the developer. At some point we will have asked him, okay, could you do this and this for us? But it's not really something developers think about when they are preparing changes or new releases, and especially when there's major upstream changes. Well, we're almost never informed, okay, this is going to happen in the next version, please prepare for it. We have a complex build environment. And that includes, again, both building the DI images themselves and then later in a second step, building the CDs. And I don't know if anybody has ever looked at Debian CD, but
I do.
That's a very nice package as well to configure. And there's a lot of ways you can go wrong. And also, DI builds for different environments. We can, the basic daily images that we produce are using initrds and UDEPs that are built in unstable, but it installs testing. And so you have a mix of environments there. When we go towards DI release in testing, we will switch that to using UDEPs and initrds from testing and still installing testing. Yeah, so there's a lot of configuration going on there as well. The reason for that is that normally when you're doing daily tests, you want to be as up-to-date as possible, so you want to use stuff from unstable that has been developed for DI itself, but you really want to install a stable environment that users can actually use, and for that testing is better, especially now the security support is starting to happen. But when you start to prepare for a beta release, well, beta releases are supposed to be based on testing, because that's the more stable environment. And we can then still continue doing some development in unstable while we're preparing the beta release. And the eye is also a fairly complex operational environment. For instance, we start with an init RD that is based on a bunch of UDEPs, but then we have to add other UDEPs to that, either from CD or load them from the network or whatever, to create a full operational DI environment. We have to configure the environment for either frame buffer operation or for dump terminal, all sorts of things like that. And often you will make a change in the DI, or there will be a change in an upstream UDEP that will work for one environment, but that will break something in another environment. If there are questions, feel free to interrupt me. So, why does the DI break? Well, lots of reasons. Really, too many to enumerate. We can, of course, break the DI ourselves, which is the easiest case, because if we break it ourselves, we almost certainly know why we broke it, how we broke it, and hopefully how to fix it. There are new upstream releases that can cause breakage. To give a random example, there was a change in dpackage fairly recently, which was the result of a wishlist bug report that was submitted by someone whose name I won't mention, but whose nick is DJ Tick. he requested that custom headers that you can use in control files. We use Debian installer menu item to determine the order in which things are shown in the Debian installer menu. And he requested that those be capitalized, the first letters. And the I used lowercase. And the software building the menu only checked for lowercase. So a new version of the package wrote the complete menu structure of the I. And it took some tracing and debugging to find what caused it. Well, then of course you have library changes. There was one, I think, day before yesterday that caused GOES some headaches because, well, he said, there's a new version of lib wireless, libIW. And so he decided, let's try if I rebuild, if that solves the problem. But then he forgot to copy the UDEPs that he created that way into his build environment, so he tested with the old software anyway, and well, he spent a lot of time debugging the problem, even when a simple rebuild actually did solve it. But stuff like that happens. As I said earlier, transitions can hit the eye fairly hard, especially major ones like we've had post-SARS. We've basically been stopped from doing any serious work over the last period because there were so many changes waiting for things to get into testing. For example, we have switched for i386 and Spark now to the 2612 kernels and i864 as well, I think. But those kernels are still not in testing, so we will use the 2612 kernels in the installer. But as we install testing for the installed system, that still the daily build still install 2.6.8 for the final system. So if you have a system with a SATA controller, which support for which was broken in 2.6.8 or at least very incomplete, you will have a perfect installation. But when you reboot, you get the 2.6.8 kernel, and well, nothing happens basically. you get pivot route errors. So that's really blocking. Another very nice one is kernel configuration changes. When a kernel maintainer decides, okay, this module was compiled in, let's modularize it. And we won't have that module in UDEP yet, so well, basically it's not available during installation. So that can break networking for some adapters, and well, often we have to wait for installation reports to tell us about it instead of finding out.
But that would be something that's relatively could be solved. If the KUB is going to make this change, then you can say, okay, we need that UDEP, and then it should work.
Yeah.
Shouldn't be.
If they would tell us, that would be very nice, but we've seen in the past that.
Yeah, maybe not just.
Shouldn't it be possible to track the config file?
Yeah, sure, it should be. And maybe we should do that. But there's. Well, we have to check anyway whether there's changes for major kernel releases, like when we change from 2.6.8 to 2.6.12. But there's really funny things going on sometimes, and there's also, for instance, if HIMAM support is enabled by a kernel maintainer, that won't have a direct impact on the UDEP situation, but it may break the eye in other interesting ways. So it's often very subtle what happens. Another thing that we are looking into together with FTP masters and release people is that currently we have to migrate UDEPs manually from unstable to testing, which means that often the package that the UDEP is derived from is already in testing while the UDEP is still unstable, and so you have an old version in testing, and in some cases that can cause problems.
At the moment, packages producing UDEPs are blocked, do not go into.
Yeah, but they are. If at the moment there is a request to the release managers to move it to testing, it will almost certainly just happen.
But with
the dev.
They come to the FTP masters and they move the UDEP and then.
The first request will be from the maintainer of the normal package to let the package in.
Yeah.
And that will not automatically at the same time let the UDEP go as well.
My experience is what I do is if I get a request, I ask the dev and boot IC that I have the request, and if I don't get a no in the following 24 hours, so I just do it. And well, but the next thing is, for example, if I unblock a package, it might still be blocked by other reasons like uninstallability. So only if the package successfully got to testing, I can ask an FTP master to also migrate the UDEP.
Yeah.
So we have at least one day difference, and sometimes just happens to be more than one day, but if I'm busy on the next day or whatever, that's something we really should fix because it puts additional work on the most installed teams or the least teams, the FTP masters, and yeah, we will basically nothing by doing it that way.
And what also is an issue there is that UDEP, just like normal packages, have version dependencies. And version dependencies in UDEP is a little bit less strongly defined and controlled than it is in normal packages. So you get all kinds of minor temporary issues from moving things from unstable to testing that we have to be alert for and we'll have to solve sometimes. And there's a very nice one, and that's the build dependencies that the TI has. This gives you a nice overview. And that's the first page. That's also the largest bit, but I've left out all the version dependencies, but you can see how it covers all architectures and what the differences are. And well, with that many dependencies in the build process, it also makes it clear that something can easily go wrong if a new version comes in of one of those packages. The second page is actually a bit special because those are dependencies that are only relevant for building the manual and not really for daily builds. So they are only used for official builds where also the DI manual, the installation guide is built. There's a very nice one here that often causes a lot of laughter because that's actually part of KDE, which means that the built environment in a stable was unusable, at least if you were not a little bit creative with copying one lib from stable to your build machine. Because KDE was in transition and being prepared for the G++ transition.
Do you think that migrating to PO4A?
Well, I have looked at both PoXML and PO4A when I was trying to decide what to use for PO translation. And there is one major difference between them, and that's that PO4A will break strings that, for instance, have a footnote in them. If you have a paragraph with a footnote in the middle of the paragraph, PO4A will take the first part, will take the part in the footnote, and will take the second part of the original sentence as separate strings.
But you can specify.
And I don't like that.
You can specify some text to ignore.
Okay. Well, I've looked into it. That's.
We would be happy to help you on that topic.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, it works. It works perfectly with PoXML, but sometimes.
Yes.
Why does the I depend on KDE? That's what you.
How broken is it to run a broken from the console that depends on KDE lists? I mean, it's just.
It's only
insane.
One lib. It's only one lib.
Yeah, sure.
Did you contact it? Because that package is maintained by very important.
Yeah.
So did he respond in a timely fashion to upload the package? Or?
Well, it wasn't a problem. It was just copying the one lib from stable and everything was fine. It was just that lib was, lib2t was already removed from stable. And if you were just keeping track of stable, it was really no problem because the lib would stay around.
Yeah.
But if you were creating a new build environment, and you would just say, okay, upcat build libs.
Yeah, right, but perhaps.
Then the lib would be missing, but it was such a minor problem, and there was only really one porter that made an issue of it. Everybody else says, okay, let's install that old lib and not worry about it. And that one guy actually deleted the build libs temporarily, which is stupid. But it's just an example of how things can break. So how do we manage it? Well, we try to prevent breaks as much as possible, but it really is something we cannot do. So the alternative we have is to detect it when it happens. How we do that is we have daily builds for all architectures of the eye. Using the latest ULEBs that are in unstable, and the page that is linked here, I'm going to switch to it now. Where is that browser? From
the
desktop. All right. So I do shift all this stuff. Sorry.
There was a panel at the top, so just try to move the cursor.
Move the mouse to the top.
No.
Not otherwise switch to another. just yell for P2.
That's right.
Control Alt Left Right.
Control Alt.
Backspace.
Shout for.
Shout for P2.
Go out and Peter, come here.
Maybe you just have to exit that first thing mode and
do it.
Franz,
I don't know.
Franz, just go on and as soon as Peter is here.
Yeah. By the way, I'll show you the page in a moment. The main thing is that Joey has set up a test lab at his home. And you can see he has currently 6 architectures there. And another 2 are being worked on. He would like to ask Matt PowerPC and...
That's what you want to know.
It used to work... Right mouse button.
Yeah. It used to work with keyboards until you don't decided to...
No,
decided to find a keyboard.
Oh, he's hurting now?
This is nice, actually, because yesterday all the successes
you
were failures.
Bigger, please.
Bigger?
Control plus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yesterday all the successes you see here were failures. And that was because of that library problem I told you about earlier. So you can see that just fixing it, or just looking at this list, you can very quickly see if there is a problem. And if I open, let's take Spring 19. If I open the link here, then you get the build log. And you can see this is a simple case of a build dependency. Not satisfied. So this really helps us to quickly see what's wrong in the daily builds.
Franz, is there a need for a MIPS build or MIPS test? Because
how do you mean?
On your page, you had something about that on your PF slide. There were only.
Oh no, that's for the test lab. The builds are covered.
Ah, okay. But you need still MIPS for the test lab.
We could look into that. That's true.
But Estra has now working as a hardware manufacturer for better devices.
He works on ARM.
Okay.
No,
okay.
JHS
was preparing some more architecture for the Tesla.
Sorry.
You were mentioning that Joey was preparing some more projects for Tesla.
Yes, he is. Well, he has problems running the Hercules emulator at the moment. So that kills off the S390 Tesla, but I can do that. I may readily do that on my laptop. And S390 isn't that important anyway, so if it breaks. There's not many installations happening all the time. And PowerPC, he doesn't have it in his test lab. I think he was going to get the machine from Sven Luther, but I'm not sure if that has happened yet. But that will be.
PowerPC64?
Sorry?
PowerPC64.
Yeah. Control.
What are you doing?
I'm trying to go back to...
I'm red.
That's a
sorry?
Level.
Wasn't it the Irons?
Also
in
Irons?
France,
yeah. Okay, so... Yeah, there it is. So, the second thing is the test lab, and that also has its own logs. So let's do the same thing again. And that's this page. And you can see there's quite a few failures.
What's that cow DNS and cow web server?
That's just the names of his machines.
Ah, okay.
He's the test machine names.
Chicken and whatever, yeah.
He was using animals as well.
And you can see there's quite a few failures here. And let's just look at my 386 failure.
Success.
Well, we can also look at success, but that's boring. No, let's not do that. Maybe I can go in your tab.
It
works in Conqueror.
Maybe about mouse click.
Let's forget it. Yeah. One thing about those things is that they are a lot harder to read than the build logs because they have more escape sequences for the graphical environments.
This GNOME environment is.
Another way we find out about breakage is through installation reports. So we really welcome those. And we are sometimes told about. Things going wrong on the IRC channels. Because of especially the daily build structure and the test lab, we will often notice things breaking before we are noticed, that is noticed in the general debian environment. Of course, we won't notice breakage in stuff like office packages or graphical editors or whatever. But if there's something wrong in bootloaders or stuff like that, we will often be the first to see it. And that also often means that you will have to track it down. So what do we do to fix breakage? Debugging and tracing, of course. If we find out what's wrong, report it. If it is something that's under our own control, well, we can fix it upload and we're done. If not, well, then it will often take a lot longer to get something fixed, file bug. And how to maintain them, keep after them to help us out. But there's quite a few packages that are not really maintained and in those cases, we often have to NMU. For instance, the Bootstrap, Mainlibs, SysV in it. All kinds of basic stuff. And we are very lucky to have Joey Hess in the team because he knows Debian so well that he can often judge what is possible to do, what's safe, what's not safe. Of course, we test things locally, which means manual builds having the right environment to test in, so you really need the architecture if it's an architecture-specific problem and the test lab comes in there again. And then you have to wait for the fix to make it to the daily builds. For sometimes types of problems, it's really outside our own knowledge, and we have to get help from porters or specialists. Internationalization problems are often like that, especially when it's to do with character combining and weird stuff like that. We have Christian Perry on the team who coordinates that part of the eye very heavily and does a terrific job with it. So, this is my last slide. What do we do to keep everybody informed that this is something we have actually added quite recently, because it was breaking so much that we thought, well, we have to do something about it?
Isn't it a wiki.debian.org in the meantime?
Not yet.
We are waiting for the transition. Like everyone. So let's see if I can.
Oh, no, not another transition.
Yeah, moving the wiki from one sector to another.
Changing the big end. Changing the way KB can be split.
You mean the wrong word? No. Capital DIT.
Yeah.
Does it work?
I always use it.
Probably yes.
So
you are.
This is the list of current issues, basically. Well, the top one we can remove now, that's been fixed. We haven't had CD builds for the last week or something like that, because we needed to update something, and Monty, who is the daily build coordinator, is really busy with university work, of course, study at the moment. So he doesn't have time to update, so Joey has decided to update himself, which was perfectly all right. But the problem is that the scripts that Monty uses to start the builds check 25 sums of the environment, and of course that fails. So now we don't have builds, which makes testing a lot harder as well. We are hoping that that slides will fix it. So, any questions? Left after this.
Yeah. One question. I've seen this deboosted and seed boosted.
Yeah.
What are you going to continue? And just ask one little move.
We are going to switch to seed deboosted. So I think we already use it, but I'm not 100% sure.
So deboosted is more or less something that we might remove with edge plus one.
Yeah, I would guess so.
Good.
Maybe even for edge, but that depends if everything that uses it, including dbuild and stuff like that.
Dbuild already switched to.
Already switched, yeah.
No, it doesn't work either, so.
Yes, I'm using
well,
state.
It worked for me yesterday, like I had to drive four times.
Is CD boosted already better than
new machine more?
It's difficult to everybody.
One question is from your point of view, CD boosted better? Or just
well, the bootstrap needs a list of packages to install per architecture, and CD Bootstrap will analyze what's required for standard installation or for imports, something like that. But I don't know the details. That's what I've understood from hearing things here. But
yeah,
that's the basic difference.
I'm wondering how the whole test lab works. How do you automatically test the installer? Do you only do second stage? Or?
Joey has set up a power control center using some home device that's available and that can be controlled through serial interface. So he will switch on the power for a machine that way.
Okay.
And everything he does is network installations, so
okay.
Network booting. So he will just make sure that the correct image is somewhere, make sure that that's good, and he has scripted it a lot. For the details, I can give you a link where he explains it a bit. And
why not?
Yes. Yeah. It's a really nice setup.
I can imagine, yeah.
Okay, other questions? Right, thanks very much for your attention.
I think we directly